Section 10, Article 2. The state shall pursue social justice in all phases of national development.
Like peace, no definition of social justice was spelled out. But it was clear that the drafting committee wanted all its dimensions relevant to the Philippine setting incorporated.
The 1935 Constitution's concern was mainly economic prosperity, and the 1973 Constitution became a little bit more explicit in that. The new article is a development beyond the 1935 Constitution. I do not see why we should allow ourselves to be nailed to the 1935 Constitution when we have liberated ourselves already from that rather limited concept of social justice. This phrase, all phases of national development, includes socio-economic, socio-political, and cultural development. We have transcended the 1935 Constitution.
Studies have shown that people do not take up arms simply because they are hungry when the law or the system, through inaction or outright denial, do not give more to those who have less in life, and as a result, human dignity and group identities are solid, then they take up arms against the government. Social justice results from the equitable use and distribution of both political power and material wealth. It requires a government committed to positive action. The Bill of Rights focused on citizens' civil and political rights, and it was left for the article on social justice to spell out economic, cultural, and social rights, especially of specific sectors disadvantaged in particular ways. In Article 13, we find social justice and human rights conjoined. The different elements of social justice were spelled out. Labor, agrarian reform, urban land reform and housing, health, women, people's organizations, and human rights. The extensive provisions on social justice for many of our commissioners are the foundation for the peace vision in the Constitution. For it is the quest for social justice that has given rise to our many insurgencies, and in its guarantee, the peaceful resolution lies.
The interesting thing is that social justice provisions were not limited to the article on social justice, which of course the first time there was a separate article, but in other places of the Constitution. If I'm asked, how would you encapsulize the Constitution in one sentence? I would say that it is that phrase in the social justice provisions that says, equitably diffusing wealth and political power for the common good. That to me is the spirit of the new constitution, and it has very important consequences to what happens in our country, because we saw that as the path to both justice and progress. That's why the separate articles on the economy and the social justice were next to each other.
A basic charter, which already, I think, you know, carries within it very strong human rights and justice provisions, which really allows us to build the kind of peaceful society which, as Pepe Diokno advised us, I remember seeking his counsel, you know, it has to address the issues of jobs and justice, food and freedom, land and liberation that would create a nation for our children. That is how Pepe Diokno, in his very succinct manner, kind of summarized what the kind of constitution we require as a people. But the social justice article or provisions in human rights, the Bill of Rights, represented the very heart of this basic document.
On my own part, one of the provisions that I'm very proud of is the provision on cooperatives. Mm-hmm. No? It's the first ever provision that recognized cooperatives as very important institutions in building communities and the nation. No?
So I think the Muslim issues, for example, the NPA issues. We tried to solve the first one with the autonomous region. and the second one with social justice, and also, for example, partyless system, which sought to give participation to marginalized national, sectoral, and regional parties. Of course, the interpretation of the Supreme Court, I think, is erroneous, that this should only be the marginalized economic sectors, because the intent and the letter of the Constitution is very clear that it is marginalized national parties, regional parties, and sectoral parties.
I think the paths are many. You know, they are found in terms of economy, in terms of equal opportunity, access. You know, but putting those in the Constitution, you know, access, participation, dialogue, you know, are intended to promote that environment where the people are more attuned to peacemaking. No, my field is communication, and I see communication as the road to peace. This is why the Supreme Court has had to enact amparo and habeas data, because of the fact that we don't have because all of these problems are due to lack of information.
To be sure, fears about arbitrary confiscation of private property and profits, wildcat strikes, the anarchy of farm and urban land takeovers were expressed on the floor as more and more rights were given to disadvantaged sectors. The same fears and affected interests continue to preempt passage and implementation of good laws. 20 years later, social justice remains unfinished business.
Did you know that our Constitution is unique for having the word love? Love in the preamble was introduced by the Catholic Bishop Teodoro Bacani.
In Catholic circles today, there are four pillars of peace: truth, justice, love, and liberty. Peace is the consequence of all these. It would seem better to put all of those four ahead of peace, peace being the result of all of them. I will explain the reason. I would really like to insert a very important factor in the people's revolution, and it is the element of pakikipagkapwa-tao, love. I was touched seeing and reading the report of how people acted in a non-violent way. Pilipino din naman kayo. Huwag ninyong sasaktan. Pilipino din naman siyang tulad natin. I think we should be aiming at the civilization of love, because a rule simply of justice and law, and even of equity, will not be able to bring peace. And so, I want to add love, even though it may not be very legalistic to hear.
Blas Oples said that it will be the first constitution in the world to embody the principle, which translates into the fraternity of all those who are united into one nation. Such a concept of love has a direct bearing on the conflicts that were dividing our nation.
And of course, I think in the constitution you find the concept, a very novel concept of love. No? So it's not just the narrow version of love, but the love as in terms of the philosophers of the human dialogue. No, you cannot enter into a dialogue with anyone unless you love him, unless you are authentic. No, so the concepts of authenticity, love, openness, transparency are all elements that are important in the human dialogue. No? And I think maybe we could use this philosophical anchor, love and peace, no?
Yes. Commissioner Rustico de los Reyes was among the 26 who voted for love. Love for him meant no more violent dispersal of peaceful rallies, no more vindictiveness, total forgiveness, peace, genuine peace and reconciliation. Some actually found love neither cute nor laudable. Commissioner Abubakar thought that it sullied the dignity of the Constitution. Villacorta argued that we cannot constitutionalize love. Suarez said that the preamble should be devoid of any romanticism. the late filmmaker Lino Broca said that the word was terribly icky and too prayerfully joyous. Broca resigned from the commission, arguing he didn't want it in the first place. Several of the 17 no votes and abstentions in the third reading of the preamble actually had something to do with this word, love. Hate it or love it, the word love is in the Constitution. Being there, it can certainly back up efforts to adopt laws and policies that uphold active nonviolence, to support the peaceful settlement of disputes, and to build a regime of truth, justice, and freedom through peaceful means. To make love, not war. The challenge is to find imaginative and compelling ways for the word love, romantic, profound, icky, whatever word, to penetrate legalism.